You know, I truly believe that you can test out the amount of yieldedness, or the level, if you would, of yieldedness of your spirit to the Holy Ghost by just checking the joy. People get in their car, and before they drive it, they check the oil. Why don't you go ahead and check your... Hallelujah. All right, well, I should say this. Before you start up the lawnmower, okay, you check the oil. Maybe you don't do it with your car. You know, you don't want to tear the thing up, okay? You don't want to ruin it. And the Lord gives us those indicators. Those are important indicators. And if we're just going to ignore them because we don't agree, then, you know, we're not going to ever really develop in the life of the Spirit. We're not going to. We'll remain as newborn babies. At very best, we'll remain as newborn babies, and we'll never mature. And it's kind of, hey, it's nice being a baby. It's frustrating. It's nice being a baby. It's very limited of what you can do, okay, being a baby. And so, you know, everybody in their right mind does not want to remain in that state. We want to grow. Life is about growing. Life is about developing. Life is about maturing. And so much so it is the case spiritually. If you want to do that, then you're going to have to pay attention to what the Lord says in the Word, because there's no fluff and stuff in the Word. Everything is specifically detailed information about what is absolutely essential for our growth and maturation. Everything, every story, every description, every detail in the Word. There is no lost extra words in the Bible. And when you get enough wisdom and insight to recognize that that is the case, then you get to start moving forward. Praise God. Hallelujah. The Lord talks to us about love and joy and peace being the indicators of the Holy Ghost, being the fruits of the Spirit, being the evidence that we're yielded to Him. And we need to get on with that. We need to recognize, wait, that's a good thing. It's a good thing to love. You may want to feel like you want to be hateful for a little while. Maybe you want to throw a little temper tantrum with anger. Don't have anger fits. If that's going on in your life, you shut that stuff off. That's demonic. Don't have anger fits. Okay. You can have a lot of different things go on in your life that you can tolerate. And a lot of people tolerate yelling. You don't allow yelling. If you've ever read my wife's book, a yell's from hell, so shout to the Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. There's just things you've got to learn that you don't yield your members to. They're going to try to come and impose themselves upon you. Going to try to activate certain things within your behavior. And you say, no, I'm not game. I'm not open. The shop's not open. Okay? Huh? The playground's closed. I mean, come on. All right? So, praise God. I'm so glad that you're here tonight with us and for the School of the Spirit. The School of the Spirit is something that, whether we realize it or not, we walk in every single day. The School of the Spirit is something that we're engaged in literally every hour of the day and every minute of the day. And when we become aware that God, the Holy Ghost, has come to teach us, as real as the disciples were dependent upon the Lord Jesus to teach them, to guide them, to mentor them, to lead them, so we are to be with the Holy Spirit, because He's come to take Jesus' place. Understand that. We need to be giving God, the Holy Ghost, the reverence and the honor as our mentor, as our leader, as our teacher that He deserves. And He wants to do this in an unseen realm because it's for our benefit. We are going to grow more when you cut off this sensual realm, the seeing realm, the hearing realm. God knows this. Okay, there's certain things that we can talk about to describe how that this is can be provably the case. You know, when a person loses their sight, their other senses start kicking in. Their perception of things go to a whole nother level of being able to be more understanding, more sympathetic. The list goes on. And that's just talking on natural terms. Father has chosen to remain in an invisible realm to interact with us in a realm that is purely spiritual, so that we could learn things that would be impossible for us to learn if He was there standing in front of us as He stood in front of the disciples. And He says to the disciples, think about this. Here He is. They're able to touch Jesus. They're able to see Him. They're able to hear Him. They're able to benefit from watching Him do the work, do the miracle. And He says to them, it is excuse me. It is expedient for you. I've been talking too much today. It's expedient for you that I go away. Because when the Holy Ghost comes, He's going to expedite this. Amen. There's things that you can't even have or understand until the Holy Ghost comes. Mm. And here we are living in that time. And so, but we've got to become aware of what's made available to us. Tonight, I'm going to spend a little time talking to you about tongues, the language of the Holy Spirit. It's a booklet that I just did. If you can kind of, can you focus in on that just a little bit so everybody on the web can see it? And then just let me know when you've zoomed in on it and then zoom right back out. Just give me a nod when you've done that. Because I want everybody to know about this. What we're going to do is, Kay's going to take up the leadership of getting it on Amazon, because what we want it on Amazon just because we've learned some things about how to bring more visibility to books and to topics on the internet. There, I finally just sat down and did this booklet. It's about a 24-page booklet or so, something. Oh, this one's like 43. Okay, it's about a 43-page booklet. And it's an easy read. And I just sat down and I did it. I pulled some things together that I already had, and I did it last week or this week, whatever, over this past couple of days. Because I'm always being asked the questions about tongues. Can everybody pray in tongues all at the same time? Can everybody speak in tongues? Because usually, generally, people say, can everybody speak in tongues all at once? Or they usually come out, you know, as an expert and with a declarative statement saying, oh, everybody can't speak in tongues all at once. And they base that on two verses of scripture that they've completely taken out of context. They don't understand. And so I'm always trying to help lead people and guide people and help them understand the precedence that is already set, the bigger view of things. And when I had a couple of people back to back, and one person out of Africa, out of Zambia, asked me, and I just said, you know what? And she asked me to send some stuff to her that I've written on it. And I thought, you know what? I'm just going to do this booklet. I've been needing to do it for a long time. You know, I need to be able to hand it to people when they come to the meeting. Or they can go right on a website and they can download it and they can understand perfectly what's going on here and what God is saying. And so I'm going to talk about the book tonight. And then once we get it on Amazon, what we want is we want everybody to go on Amazon and we want you to review it. I think is what we want you to do. I mean, I think we have to offer it for 99 cents. I wanted to give it for free. But I'm sure everybody can afford 99 cents. And you just go ahead and buy it. Even though you could download it for free at our website. And we're making a website for the booklet itself. Why? Because we want to utilize what is available right now to be able to preach the gospel. And that there's nothing like the internet. And somebody in this place, and I believe we've got some people really starting to get it, are going to have to really learn that, wait a minute, you can throw into the gospel and begin to understand how to effectively utilize these kinds of forums and preach the gospel to millions of people with, you know, not a whole lot of having to, you know, spend $100,000 on it or even having to spend, you know, 100 days on it. So if you can begin to say, wait a minute, I want to be used by God more. And you're pacing the floor. Lord, I want to be used by you more. Most of the time, God the Holy Ghost is going to say, what's in your hand? What do you know how to do? What's your skill set? You know, what have you trained to be able to do? You can take whatever you've trained to be able to do, whatever you know, and you can put it to his use. And of course, Father will take us way beyond that, and that's not always the case, but generally, it is the case. And if we can get people everywhere to recognize, wait a minute, you got to understand, you're in a church, and just because you're not the pastor or the leader doesn't mean that the responsibility isn't on your shoulder to build that church and to participate with that church, to see that church be everything that God's purposed that church to be in the kingdom, reaching the lost and seeing people established. And if you don't get that, if you're always just needing, you know, I need to be fed, I need to be dieted, give me a, you know, almost, it's really, truly, it's almost this way. It's like, put the bib on me. I can't even put my own bib on. And no, you have to realize, pastors from a spiritual point of view, go through this with folks. And they don't see it from a spiritual point of view. They thought everybody should be happy just because they showed up. We are happy that you showed up. But there's far more to your walk with the Lord Jesus Christ than you showing up.
Amen.
There's far more to your spiritual development than somebody spoon feeding you everything that you have in relationship with the Lord. So he said, oh, I never knew that. Well, you could have known that if you got down on your knees and prayed and asked God, he'd have showed you. You know, if you just opened up your Bible and read for more than 5 minutes, this would have come to you. You know what I'm saying? So, yeah. These things are important. We've got to get this. And this is the school of the Spirit. This is growth and maturity. I've watched people, be just so, remorseful and just like, oh, I don't know what I did wrong. And, because time has gone by and they didn't have or develop or, step into all the things that Father had for them, or even maybe sometimes even a fraction of the things that God had for them. And the reality of it was, by and large, they did never really fully engaged. It was like, going to work and sitting in the break room for 8 hours and then wondering why, you didn't get, it would be a miracle if you didn't get fired, okay? It would be a miracle if you didn't get fired. I mean, who's going to hire somebody to sit in the break room, okay? Or you never, maybe you didn't sit in the break room 8 hours a day, but you were constantly, taking a break. And, it's like you were always on break. Even though it was like you were only going on break 15 minutes out of every hour. Once again, you're not going to get promoted. You're not going to get, you're not going to develop there if the ownership is just going to be willing to say, well, the 45 minutes I get out of them of an hour is worth it to have them. Well, we're going to get you, unfortunately, we allow you to get away with that. In the church, we allow you to get away with sitting in the break room for 8 hours. Huh? We allow those kinds of things because it's become the culture of the church, but it is not the culture of the church. It is just a modern day facilitator mentality of what people perceive the church to be. The church is not that. It's not described that in the New Testament. God has called us to labor. He's called us to bring forth fruit. He's called us as leaders to be fruit inspectors. We understand how Jesus feels about a tree that doesn't bring forth fruit. Huh? He said, why cumbereth it the ground? Fire it. No, it's true. He holds us to responsibility because it's for our own growth and maturity. If you're not going to engage in something, you're never going to develop in it. You're never going to be strengthened. So ultimately, it is an act of injustice against you not to demand you to do those things that are essential for your growth. And of course, if it was our children and they weren't eating, we'd find out what we've got to do to make them eat. I mean, whether we seem to be tyrants in controlling people or not. You know what I'm saying? My child's not eating, I'm going to control the situation. I'm going to mandate you eating one way or the other. We got to go get, a feed tube. We're going to do something. Okay. And so these are basic things that people have got to get a hold of. And if you will do them, and I don't care, listen to me. If you're sitting there and you're a church right now of 10 people, if you could activate, if all 10 of you would activate right now to say, we all carry the responsibility and the burden to see this church grow, and you create a plan on how you're going to begin to go out, take care of people, reach people, be activated, and in moving in that which Father has given us the ability to move in, inside of 2 years, you'll be 200. The reality of it is, it's just getting 10 people that are willing to do it. So if you only have 10 people, you guys are great. You're probably one of the biggest churches, potential churches in your area. If you could get everybody on the same page and get everybody activated. The longer you let people sit around, the more likely they're just gonna continue to sit around and becomes a culture of sitting around. Yep, in the break room 8 hours a day and wondering why we're not getting anywhere. So moving on now, I'm going to talk to you about tongues. And I want to talk to you, and I'm going to say the statement this. I can prove to you that it is absolutely biblical for everybody to speak in tongues all at the same time. And I'm going to use a general terminology, even though that in some respects isn't altogether accurate. Because speaking denotes a message. And so it's not okay for everybody to give a message all at the same time. Aren't you glad that I don't have five other people up here with microphones talking about five other subjects, or even talking about the same subject, but they are talking it on the basis of how they want to deliver the message, because everybody's going to be confused and we don't hear anything and this is crazy, get out of here. And then what if we had that, five people giving a message, and we had a couple of people with their bangs popping out of the side of their neck, and they're screaming over top of each other in the language of the Spirit, screaming and hollering and getting all excited. And while that's going on, you know, everybody else is doing something different. It'd be total confusion. The Lord, the things that Paul says in 1 Corinthians 14 are literally that logical. They're that logical. It's sensible. Well, what we have is we've got a bunch of people trying to tell us about how the Holy Ghost moves, and they've never had one moment of a move. They've never had a move. They've never had a moment of a movement. Are you with me? They know nothing about the practical application of the Holy Ghost. And then also, they lack a general description of it and understanding the details in light of a vista view, a Holy Ghost vista view. And light, you know, you just, so many people on any subject, they get lost in the forest. If they could just back up and look at the big picture of why you need to add 2 + 2, then we could begin to think of it more logically, you know, rather than in an isolated fashion. And many people have done that with 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 24 through 25. And so that's what this booklet's all about, to help you. So the first thing that, you know, that I like to point out to everyone is that when you look at the general view of the gift of tongues, well, which I don't like to say gift of tongues, but it's okay to say that because it's more than that. It's the language of the Holy Ghost. Yes. So when the Holy Ghost was poured out, why was he poured out? Was he poured out so that you and I could be born again? No, he wasn't poured out so you and I could be born again. He was poured out on the day of Pentecost so that we could receive the power to be the witnesses of the Lord Jesus Christ, of his resurrection, a power to be able to function in the authority and the power of heaven for signs and wonders and miracles. This is the demonstration of the Holy Ghost. That's why he came. And that's why he came as he did on the day of Pentecost. And of course, the Holy Spirit is responsible for the new birth. But we know that the new birth and the baptism of the Holy Ghost in power are two separate events. And we get to see that very clearly in Acts chapter 8. And that's the only place that you see it clearly. That is it. It doesn't exist anywhere else clearly demarcated at all. And when people try to prove it somewhere else, it's very convoluted. But you get to go to Samaria, and you get to see Philip preach Jesus, and you get to see that wonderful work as they all beheld the miracles which he did. Joy filled the city, huh? Many believed, and they were baptized in water. But the Holy Ghost had fallen upon none of them. The Pentecostal endowment with power, the Holy Ghost had fallen upon none of them. Not only does Samaria allow us to see a separation between the new birth, because everybody in every church denomination is fundamentally going to call salvation having been fulfilled by people believing and being baptized in water. Pretty much leaves out no denomination, according to what we believe in the church today. So we know that there was salvation, and the gift of salvation had come. But we not only get to see that, but we also get to see the disciples, the apostles, the early church, commitment to everybody getting baptized in the Holy Spirit. Amen. That's absolute. There's no question about it. So Peter and John now says, having heard about what's going on in Samaria, says, we're going to go down there, check things out, make sure everything's going good. And they get down there, and as soon as they come, they're basically, we can see Peter with the same kind of commitment that the Apostle Paul had at Ephesus. As soon as they got down there, although the scripture doesn't say this, we can understand that what they were saying is, have you guys received the baptism of the Holy Ghost yet? Philip, did the baptism of the Holy Ghost come on these folks yet? This is that's their first interest. We get to see the impact, the effect, but we don't get to see the first interest in terms of them vocalizing it, but we can assume and know for sure, okay? It's just like, I'll give you an example. Philip's talking to the eunuch. As far as what we understood that Philip said, He was just talking some basic things about Isaiah 53. But we can know from what the eunuch said that Peter also talked to him about water baptism, because the eunuch said, what hinders me from being baptized? Are you with me? So we get to understand the dialogue to some respect of the whole picture of what was going on by seeing the results. We know that that's where Peter was at, just like Paul was at when he saw the 12 disciples at Ephesus. Have you received the Holy Ghost since you believe? And I'm telling you right now, if any of them came, they would be saying the same thing to many of the churches today. Reality of it is, when you even back up before Pentecost, you understand that Jesus was identified as the one who would baptize in the Holy Ghost. John said, I'm baptizing you in the water. That's taking a person and sticking them down under the water, okay? Jesus is going to baptize you in the Holy Ghost. Jesus is telling us, John is telling us that the Jesus ministry, the heavenly Jesus ministry, is to take you and me and immerse us down in the Holy Ghost. What an amazing thing. So the tongues was the proof and the witness, though no one could predict it. No, though it was beyond all that anybody could have ever imagined. It was the proof and the evidence that Jesus, the baptizer, had just come into that situation in the church and baptized, immersed everybody down into the glory of the Holy Ghost, just like John had baptized them down in water. And you can hear that message still being repeated many years later, just a few years before Paul's death. You know, many years later, 20, 30 years later, after the resurrection, here's Paul still saying the same message. John baptized with water, but he said there was going to be one who come after him, baptize you with the Holy Ghost, and that's what we're here to minister to you. Topic number one. Topic number one in the New Testament. Topic number one. And so when we see the Holy Ghost come to be our teacher, to be our leader, to be our guide, to show us how to have a divine hookup with all the power and authority that God invested in the believer, we hear that announcement in terms of everybody at the same time, 120 people speaking, praying, singing, declaring what they were doing, but as the Holy Ghost gave them utterance. So we could just simply say speaking. They all began to speak with other tongues, the language of the Spirit, as the Holy Ghost gave them utterance. And to think that somehow that utterance was falling on them one at a time is absolutely absurd. The text doesn't in any way indicate that. In fact, it indicates the opposite, because in a very short time, everybody, this has been noised abroad. That sound was a supernatural sound that calls Jerusalem together around in a small building, near a small building where 120 people were meeting. A noise was noised abroad. And that isn't necessarily the gossip channel. It was noised abroad. It was a rushing mighty wind. There was a sound of this thunderous river coming out. All of the things that this is all about, the Lord just building this thing up. You'll receive the promise of the Father. You'll be endued with power from on high. Out of your belly shall come rivers of living water. The spake of the Holy Ghost. I mean, this is like thing is being built up, and now it explodes on the scene, and it's like something that no one thought, what is this? And it's a language that no one's ever heard before. It is a new kind of a language. Now, 14 different dialects, as is outlined in Acts chapter 2, heard, each one in their own language. They heard. It wasn't being spoken, each one in their own language. They heard, each one in their own language, as these tongues were simply the worship and the praise and the thanksgiving and the adoration that was being expressed by the Holy Ghost through them of who God is. And that's part of prophecy. Part of prophecy is not only the declaring what Father is wanting to reveal, but it's declaring who Father is. And that's what was going on in the context of this tongue. Now remember that in the framework of 14 dialects, I promise you, everybody, it took in the majority of all languages. Come on. Everybody who was standing there was being serviced. Yet, there were still others who could not hear anything but tongues. So we have a group of people that are eyewitness to us in the scripture that, no, they're speaking in tongues. You got a bunch of other people out there saying, no, I hear in my own dialect. Don't you hear that? And all I hear is tongues. All I hear is a bunch of people, they're mocking. All I hear is a bunch of people that sound like they're full of debauchery, excess of wine, the drunk. Huh? Religion's still saying it today. It's just debauchery. It's reproachful. It's demonic. Give me a break. All you're doing is saying you are a part of the group that, and there were others mocking. There were those who were hearing. Their ears were open to hear, but there were others that were mocking. Things go on. Same thing goes on today. Most important thing for me to do is to make sure that I equip you to cut down, throw down, stop, just demolish every lie that Satan would try to attack the truth with. And, you know, dear people, I'm going to tell you, I've read all the commentaries. I've read all of the major commentaries on the subject, from the Episcopalian to the Presbyterian, the Roman Catholic, the various different Calvinistic denominations, Methodist, Nazarene, Pentecostal. Look, I'm not just talking from some isolated perspective. I've read very broadly, but I can also tell you, in reading very broadly, but primarily the thing I hear is nothing but a bunch of wild-eyed, man-made speculation declaring things that God had not even come close to saying. So you've got to really be desperate to believe these commentaries. You got to be desperate to try to find some way out of not having this wonderful experience, which I understand. I understand that to the natural mind, it is foolishness. Because that's what Paul helped everybody understand in 1 Corinthians chapter 2. To the natural mind, beginning verse 12, to the natural mind, these things are foolish. They cannot be understood. The things of the Spirit of God cannot be received nor understood. It doesn't make any sense. It is despicable. It's reproachful. It doesn't look fashionable. It's like David, almost like stripping down and dancing with all of his might before the ark. Despicable. Michael, his wife, despised him from that day. It's just the way of God, the kingdom of God. The things of the Spirit are as different from the ways of men as the kingdom of God is from the kingdom of men. And we're just going to have to understand this. And you're not going to get to drink of the things that belong to heaven until you're willing to humble yourself and quit, you know, having to, you know, tell everybody how to act. And having your behavior shaped by your culture. God wants your behavior to be shaped by the Holy Ghost. Amen. Who can understand how the seraphims go at it as they fly around screaming and hollering? To the top of their lungs, holy, holy, holy. Come on. Yeah, heaven's different than the earth. God's different than man. And I'm so glad it's that way. I'll tell you right now, if you're stuck in culture, my goodness, people, there's 196 different nations with 196 different cultures, and there's more cultures than that, because you take one nation like Papua New Guinea, and Papua New Guinea, within Papua New Guinea, I think there's 1,800 different cultures. I mean, if you're gonna, what culture's sacred? It's all messed up. God's come to interrupt all this stuff that Satan has imposed upon us and show us a heavenly existence. And so when I speak in tongues, it is a miracle. Yes. It isn't something common and ordinary. It is a testimony that God, the Holy Ghost, is on the inside equipping me with everything that belongs to the supernatural power of God to do the works of Jesus. and that he's teaching me through this ability to storomana ete, to also speak in such a way that I don't process it through my experience or through my thinking realm. It just flows out in the same way. He's teaching me how to hook up with a supernatural realm of faith that really was never given to any of the prophets of old. They received a measure of faith, and there was only a few men select over the generations of men who were even allowed access to the Holy Ghost. And now he's poured out the Holy Ghost upon all flesh, anyone who's willing to participate.
Hallelujah.
And how it is then that men are trying to say, well, I don't believe we all have to speak with tongues. How is it that men are trying to get out of it? How is it that men are trying to find an excuse to get out of the best thing God ever gave? Outside of his only begotten Son. Father gave us those two most special things. He gave us his only begotten Son. This day have I begotten you. When he gave to us Christ Jesus as a holy embryo in the womb of a virgin named Mary. When he gave to us his only begotten Son as the miracle and signs and wonder worker to prove in every dimension that Father has authority over all sickness and disease and over all the power of the enemy. When he gave us his only begotten Son, who was there at the whipping post being chastised for our peace, who by whose stripes every disease and every sickness was cured, who gave to us his only begotten Son on a cross called Calvary to there bear our sins in his own body on the tree, who gave his only begotten Son, who having finished the work and gave up the ghost, went down into hell for me so I never have to go there. Oh, Sapaharatai, who gave his only begotten Son when he raised up from the dead to impart unto me and you resurrection life.
Hallelujah.
My goodness. You're trying to get out of the only one who can be able to equip us to be able to describe and to make these things known. I'm not going to be left out. With humility and brokenness and hunger and thirsting, I open up the Bible and say, I want it all. Oh God, what next? Oh God, when are you going to do it? Please do it now. I mean, because there's no way you can ever have these things in your life without hunger and thirst. There's no way you can ever have these things in your life without earnestly desiring. And that's why Paul opens up 1 Corinthians chapter 14 and says, earnestly desire the spiritual. And when he says it that way in 1 Corinthians chapter 14, in verse 1, he contrasts it with prophecy, saying, and much more to prophesy. And he's not demoting in any way or belittling or making the gift of the language of the Spirit less. He's just saying, look, within the context of the church, yes, tongues belong in the church. It's resident in the church. It's a gift put in the church as much as apostles, as much as prophets, as much as teachers, as much as governments, as much as anything else. But you've got to understand the church has also got to be focused on reaching the lost and seeing people established. And so that's why a person who prophesies greater than he that speaks in tongues, because the person who's speaking in tongues is only building themselves up. But guess what? He wants you to be built up, and you need to be built up so that the manifestation of the Spirit can come through you. Because what God showed to us in the baptismal anointing and in the divine power that God gave to us that is unlimited, like and excessive, like rivers, is that it would be activated and developed by the language of the Spirit. That it was from that then, and that's one of the big topics of 1 Corinthians chapter 14 that is not being discussed, that from it, it would cause you to develop, it would cause you to increase, it would cause you to excel. It would promote you and to be able to operate in the word of knowledge, in the word of wisdom, in the discerning of spirits, in the gift of faith, in the working of miracles, in the gifts of healing. Excelling is essential. Paul's going to hit it over and over and over and over again. And we can see the excelling that takes place. For example, with Peter, when we look at the general overview of how the church was born and the announcement that the Holy Ghost is here, and now it's more than an announcement of the Holy Ghost is here, it's the announcement of this is how I'm going to do it.
Yeah. Amen.
It's not just an announcement of just a little thrill of ecstasy for just one moment. It's the Holy Ghost saying, I'm here and this is how I'm working. Yeah. I'm here and this is how I'm going to do it in you. Yeah. Hello. And then Paul then takes in 1 Corinthians 14 and emphasizes that this spiritual, this language of the Spirit is the means by which we are built up, by which we are strengthened so that we might excel. And we look at Peter and it wasn't long as he's that he excels and that he steps right over into now speaking also by revelation. Paul said, if I come speaking by tongues in 1 Corinthians 4, 14, verse 6, how will it profit you lest I speak by revelation? Yeah. He's going to name revelation. He's going to name knowledge. He's going to name prophecy. And he's going to name teachings, which we translate most of the time doctrines. And I think I put doctrines in here. I need to change it to teaching. Because I think that people think that that means that somehow, you know, we're going to take Strong's exhaustive concordance. We got people right now that believe that you can function and learn how to function in the things that are described in 1 Corinthians chapter 14 through the hermeneutical and exegetical process learned in seminary. That is just crazy. That is absolutely bizarre. That's not opinionated. That is just reality. That is cutting through the mustard, as they say, and getting to the point. Hallelujah. I personally feel like I'm talking just like Jesus. For me, I look just come to the meeting. I see Father, Christ Jesus, the Holy Ghost sitting on the front row, and I'm ministering to them. And so long as they're giving me a thumb up and a nod, I'm going for it. No matter what anybody else is doing. Does God expect the natural mind to understand anything that belongs to heaven? No, because you're going to try to always interpret it based upon earthly experience, and you're going to every time 100% get it wrong. You have to learn how to receive the Holy Ghost to show you how to see right, hear right, and think right. He'll cause you to see what eyes have never seen, hear what ears have never heard, and understand what has never, 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 never entered into your understanding realm of your heart. You've never thought about it. You do not know it. You cannot possibly know it. It does not relate to anything that you've experienced. And everything that you try to process, you connect with something that you already know about. That's the way the mind works. That's the way memory works. Don't work here. Hallelujah. Kodabasareya is the scrubber. Shedobrabata is the scrubber. It makes irrelevant all your experience, all your understanding, all of your knowledge, all your ability to connect the dots. Right? You're supposed to be connecting the dots and it's going to be a sailboat. I'm going to tell you right now, the way that people have been connecting the dots, it don't look like nothing. You know what I mean? The little kids thing, connect the dots, you get a little picture, and somebody didn't get it. Actually, when you connect the dots, you're supposed to look like the picture. Oh, you just went right to connecting the dots, whatever just, you know, inspired you. It's abstract, whatever. You didn't get it. Huh? Didn't stay, look at it long enough, look at the picture, look at the dots, look at the picture. Then you start saying, oh, I can see that. And then are you with me? Yeah. Come on, people. Come on, people. Yeah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You have to look at the Holy Ghost. Yeah. Yeah. You have to look at Jesus. Yeah. You have to look at the ministry of Jesus. Yeah. You have to look at heaven. Amen. Start to understand how these dots are to be connected. Amen. Huh? Don't go to start connecting the dots. You're going to come up as short as these theologians has written these long commentaries that they sell their volumes for, like, you know, excessive amounts of money. Excessive amounts of money to read that. And I paid it. And I paid for it. Hallelujah. Well, you know, it gives me a burden for him and intercede. Hallelujah. So when we begin to think about then how Peter steps into a revelation and he says, this is that which was spoken by the prophet Joel. It shall come to pass in the last days, saith God, I pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and you shall prophesy. Your old men shall see dreams. Your young men shall have visions. Okay? The sun will be turned into blood. It's a sackcloth, and the moon will be turned into blood. So before that great notable day of the Lord. So he goes through a long list of what was going to happen in the last days. Okay? He's saying this is that. And he's saying this is the initiation of that. Because the moon wasn't turned into blood, the sun didn't dark. Are you with me? I want us to work back, okay? Because somebody says, see, you know, they weren't speaking in tongues, they were prophesying. They were speaking in tongues. Hello. They look, as the Holy Ghost gave them utterance. You cannot erase that verse of scripture and jump to another one and say, no, they were prophesying. And that's no. You could at best say this is a new kind of New Testament prophecy. At best. But we're going to see that. We're going to see Peter excel. And we're going to hear Paul say it over and again. Excel. He wants us to excel. And this is something that is repeated over and over again. So that when you look at Cornelius' house, they get saved and baptized in the Holy Ghost all at once. So it looks like the salvation and the Holy Ghost are almost the same thing. And Peter goes up to Jerusalem and says, look, guys, there's proof that the Lord has saved them too. Look, they got baptized in the Holy Ghost. And that's what the United Pentecostal Jesus Church, Church of Jesus only. That's one of the reasons they teach what they teach. That's one of their texts that they try to prove that the witness of salvation is tongues. But you got to take the whole counsel of God. You can't just take one part. Everything's got to agree together. It's all got to fit in here, huh? Yeah. It can come all at once. I've seen people, they got baptized in the Holy Ghost before they got saved. I mean, they got saved so quick. They didn't even say nothing. They're baptized in the Holy Ghost before they said Jesus come into my heart. Well, they had said it in enough of a way in their heart, in enough of the way of their response, that God had already counted it. They never verbally said, as we usually go through, everybody comes up, we stand up here and say, repeat after me. God can do this any way he wants to do it.
True. Yeah.
Hallelujah. The bigger issue is letting them get it done. And having what those who got it done. Huh? You can listen, I'm going to tell you right now, if you're standing around the river and everybody's swimming and you're in there fully dressed in your suit and your hair's dry, you can't say you swimming too. And if you say you swimming too, you're the only person who believes it, and we're walking around you because we think you're crazy. We don't know what you're going to do next. Everybody that's swimming is wet. If you got your suit on or your full, you know, whether you got your full, you know, business suit on or your swimming suit. You're wet. You're baptized in the Holy Ghost. You're speaking in tongues.
Amen.
And if you're not, you're the guy that's standing on the water, on the riverbank, dressed in your business suit, saying you're wet. At Cornelius' house, they spake with Adostoparababataya. When Paul addressed the church, addressed the disciples at Ephesus, very specifically, have you received the Holy Ghost since you believed? As soon as they received the Holy Ghost, they spake with tongues. Hallelujah. All at once. And there's nobody saying, hey, stop. Right. One by one, Courtney, while you, they're messing it up. God just poured it out and now they're messing up. This isn't something that men are doing. And people say, well, your spirit is praying. Well, you need to understand what your spirit is praying. This isn't something that originates from you, that you own, that you possess, that belongs to your utterance and it's your creation. That is nonsense. It is by the precedence is that the Holy Ghost give us the utterance. And praise God, the Holy Spirit is joined unto our spirit, is joined unto His spirit. And He's supposed to be ruling over our spirit. And so when the Holy Ghost Spirit's doing it, our spirit's doing it. And then, you know, Paul tells us to continue to be filled with the Spirit. And he tells us to pray with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit. And he says, well, what am I going to do? I'm going to pray with my Spirit, pray with the Spirit and pray with the understanding also. And then somebody comes up with a brilliant observation and says, well, over there in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 18, it's a capital S for Spirit. And then over there in 1 Corinthians chapter 14, verse 15, it's a small s for Spirit. And then they don't realize, wait a minute, that was based upon the preference of the translator, right, who has a subjective preference to put a small S for man and a big S for God, depending upon how he reads the context. Well, I'm going to tell you right now, 1 Corinthians chapter 14, 15 is God. It's God. I will pray in the Spirit. Hallelujah. Just like they prayed in the Spirit on Acts 2:4, it's same Spirit and same utterance giver.
Amen.
Hello.
Amen.
Now we're talking some sense over here. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Whew. And if he says, my spirit prays, but my understanding is unfruitful, that's fine. My spirit is hooked up with God, the Holy Spirit, and that's why I'm able to have these utterances. until I got a new spirit, my spirit could never be submitted to the Spirit of God, and I couldn't receive the things that the Spirit of God was supplying. That's why I got a new spirit. Hallelujah. Let's get the whole picture in over here. In Jesus' name. Praise God for knowledge. And praise God for understanding also, so we know what that knowledge is supposed to be. What that knowledge is saying to us. Amen.
Amen.
And so, you know, Paul's making a profound argument for you and I, and this profound argument needs to be emphasized, and it cannot be emphasized enough, that you need to be excelling with that language of the Spirit.
Amen.
And that language of the Spirit is always going to still be there, even when we're excelling, but you need to excel with it. It needs to turn in to something. I'm going to tell you what, I'm going to do what Paul did. I'm going to pray in the Spirit, and I'm going to pray with the understanding also. I'm not going to stop short of just praying in the Spirit. I watch people all the time. Pray in the Spirit, stop short of praying in the understanding also. Well, I'm not going to tolerate that. That ain't even right. It's supposed to excel.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I'm going to sing in the Spirit. Am I singing with understanding also? I'm not going to stop short. Neither I'm going to make it up. I'm going to bow to the side of a day and Adamaya until the flow, just the same way, comes out in a prayer. I'm not going to sit there and figure it out. I mean, I'm telling you right now, if the anointing's high and the flow is great while you're, and then you go to trying to think of something to pray and it just all goes out, you know, out of the room. And it turns into a struggle. Pray some more in the Holy Ghost. Build yourself up some more. Get the hook up. So God, the Holy Spirit, can pray through you with the understanding also, just like He's praying through you with the language. That no man understandeth. Brilliant scholars spent years and years in school don't get that. Brilliant. Brilliant scholars, they never get that no man understandeth. That's verse 2 of 1 Corinthians chapter 14. If I can help you right tonight, I can give you right now the ability to just about defeat every argument against tongues right there. And all the other sideline explanations where somebody said, well, I just believe they didn't have language schools back then, and I just believe that that's how the Holy Ghost gave them, you know, stupid fishermen, the ability to be able to communicate to a vast world around them. That doesn't make any sense at all. Culturally, contextually, it doesn't make any sense at all. Even if you try to make sense of it, as the Holy Ghost gave them utterance, a tongue, that no man understandeth. Because that's what tongues is. It's tongues in 1 Corinthians chapter 14, verse 2, is the exact same tongues of Acts chapter 2, verse 4. Same God wrote it. Hallelujah. Same Holy Ghost gave it. Huh? These aren't two different Bibles merged together to try to make an eclectic, you know, commentary on a Baha'i type of faith. If you understood what I just said. Are you listening to me? A merging of truths. Are you listening to me? And it'll help you. We don't go with ideas and concepts and doctrines that have contradictions in the Bible. Somebody said, I found a contradiction in the Bible. No, you just found out that what you believed was wrong. Ha! That's all you found out. You just found out that the way you understood that verse of Scripture was completely invalidated because there are no contradictions in the Bible. True. Praise God. Hallelujah. If you could understand that, you become more brilliant than most people that have been given a THD or a Doctorate of Divinity from Princeton, Yale, Oxford. And oh, I could just see religion getting a red face. They're about to blow up right now. I can see people killing over with a heart attack. They're screaming right now at the monitor. It's demonic. It's a demonic manifestation against the anointing. It's true. Hallelujah. But here, let's just look at it. Let's look at the big picture over here. Number one, we're supposed to be desiring it. Number two, come on now, listen to me. Number two, no man understanding, you're speaking to God. Number three, you're excelling in it. And I list 16 reasons for tongues in the church in this booklet. 16 reasons why you want tongues in the church. Huh?
Yeah.
But this thing about it. Describing to us a function in the church. And so the people that are saying you can't all speak in tongues at the same time, in their church, there's not even one person speaking in tongues. Not even one. Not one. And besides that, there can be no confusion on that you are all supposed to be prophesying one by one. That is a command. All prophesying one by one. And this is how the gospel is going to be preached. You talk about a mess. You talk about a logistical nightmare. Let everybody be prophesying. With the latitudes wide open, and let the prophets that are there judge. The role of the prophets. Two to three. Let it be established. You can say yay, amen. So you got the role of the prophets. And if they go amen at the end of your prophecy, you're in good shape. If they silent or turn around and kind of look at you like this. Best thing is to do is quit while you're ahead. We need that. We need the order of the church. But unfortunately, because God's people are so busy with other things, I mean, it's like one or two people got to wear many hats. I'll put my pastor hat on. I'm going to put my prophet hat on. Now I'm going to put my teacher hat on. You know what I'm saying? Over here, hallelujah. Help us, Jesus. He is. But we got to participate. The order of the church. You need to say this. We need to take on our personal responsibility, because we just like to read about things and we want like to intellectualize them, and we like to workshop them, and you know, we like to, you know, dry lab them. Huh? Come up with some predictive data of what it would look like if it happened. Work out a few 3D models on the program. No. We got to bear the responsibility. Hallelujah. Too many people burying the responsibility. We need to bear the responsibility that this is what I'm going to do.
Amen.
I shall desire and continue to earnestly desire the spiritual, and I will
Amen.
Prophesy.
Amen.
I will prophesy, because I'm going to see you step over into that which God has purposed for you to fulfill.
Amen.
That He then plants within our spirit through the declaration of His word to produce the miracle in our lives. So that we know how to hook up with the anointing and how to hook up with faith, so that we get to move with God.
Amen.
You don't know what God's doing, you can never do it with Him.
Right. True.
If you don't know where He's called you to do, what He's called you to do, what He's called you to say, you can never move in faith to do it and say it.
Yeah.
So, the model of the church finds us standing here praying in the Spirit, which is praying in tongues, praying in the language of the Spirit, singing in the Spirit, singing in the language of the tongues. Now, let's just imagine that. What culture ever, any time in the world, have you ever seen anybody sing one at a time? You sing. We're all going to sit down and listen. Now, shut up. My turn. I sing. Now you sing. Now we go around and around like, that is the most ludicrous model I've ever heard of. Who doesn't sing all at once? That's what my book talks about. Who doesn't sing all at once? And in what culture ever has there been such a methodology? And my goodness, are you telling me that there can never be at any time everybody praying all together? That is just, once again, ridiculous. We over and again, you see the whole company of God's people lift up their voice and pray together.
Amen. Amen.
Who cares what they're saying? You're not sitting and listening to them. I'm trying to understand something. Everybody's praying.
Yeah.
Hello.
Yeah. Yes.
And if you can do that with your understanding, why can't you do it in the Spirit? And Paul never in any way forbade it or wrote any kind of prohibition against it.
Amen.
And it was nonsense to think that he needed to further explain himself here.
Amen.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Knock, knock, knock.
Yeah.
I'm banging on your door. Please open it. Of course, you can all pray in the Spirit at the same time in church. Of course, you can all pray with the understanding at the same time in church. Of course, you can all sing at the same time in the spirit in church. Of course, you can all sing with the understanding at the same time in church. And if you're not going to allow for singing in the spirit, everybody at the same time, then you just need to go ahead and shut down in your 13,000 church member church. Everybody's singing with the understanding at the same time. Let them all sing individually and see how long your service lasts. Give everybody a couple of phrases. Now, you can't be singing while I'm singing. It's out of order. That is ludicrous. The Lord is not even talking about that. He's never even made that point. It's just absolutely, just completely, not only is it defying text, it's defying any kind of sensible and rational thinking. People, let's quit being bamboozled by the stupidity of Satan. I mean, every one of his arguments should easily be able to be broken down. Every one of his arguments should easily be able to be stopped by the wisdom of God.
Amen.
Hello.
Amen.
Come on. In the name of Jesus, you're going to get it.
Amen.
Now you're going to be that much more excited about what God's doing, recognizing this is how Father's activating the miracle.
Amen.
This is how God is causing me to connect.
Amen.
With the kind of prayer he wants to
Amen.
Pray through me.
Amen.
Hallelujah. The intercession of the Spirit.
Amen.
Praying after the mind of Christ,
Amen.
As Romans chapter 8, verse 26 brings out.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
That's what my book's about.
Praise you.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And I pray every one of you read. I know that there's so many people asking this question because I can feel it. I've felt it for years. I can feel many people in the Baptist church, many people in the Presbyterian church, many people in, you know, the Methodist church, they know deep inside this is something that they want. And everywhere they turn, they try to find information about it. All it's doing is giving lies, information that is absolutely not anything that God is saying in his word regarding these things. Making it something that belongs to the first century church only. No, he's come to live and abide with us forever. He's still the leader. He's still the guide. He's still the teacher. He's the baptism of the Holy Ghost is still as viable and still as real today as it was the first day.
Amen. Hallelujah.
The manifestation of the Spirit is supposed to be working and operating in every church and every person. And it's not because people aren't excelling.
Amen.
They're not excelling. In the name of Jesus. Excuse me. In the name of Jesus, you're going to excel.
Amen.
Hallelujah. If you don't have faith for it, if you don't know where you're going, if you've not been seated for where you're going, if you don't know how to participate with the Holy Ghost, you're not going to excel. And then you're not going to grow. There's not going to be a maturation. Somehow you haven't moved forward. And you understand this. It's the responsibility fundamentally in church, but it's also the activation of the purpose of why you've been endued with power outside the church. Have we been endued with power from on high for the church? Absolutely. Because these gifts of the Spirit are supposed to be working in the church. And then everybody's prophesying one by one. The unbeliever comes in. The secrets of his heart be being made known. Huh? And that's unique from the Word of God. It's sharper than any two-edged sword. Huh? Which is a discerner of thought, a discerner of thought and intent of the heart. Some of you just want to make that, you know, you're going to prophesy and it's going to be equivalent to. No, it's unique. It is specifically prophecy being expressed in some respects as the word of knowledge. It's the knowing, it's the revealing of the secrets of men's hearts, as Jesus did with Nathanael. Look at the impact it had on Nathanael. He went from being a doubter and a skeptic to saying to a worshiper of Jesus, saying, "My Lord, my God." Now we're going to have to recognize, the power, the anointing, the baptism of the Holy Ghost, it was first given to the church in the context of the church. It resides in the church. It's seen to a practical application of the church. Somebody says that tongues has no value in the church. That doesn't make any sense at all from its inception. That is something that's supposed to be done away in secret by yourself. That is absolutely, completely out of context of the revelation of how it come and why it's used. And then the scripture after scripture overthrows it. It's in the tongues, in the church. God put it in the church for the purpose that he described. And it's not just to be interpreted. Then just be interpreted. Because singing in the Spirit, singing in understanding also, is does not imply an interpretation. You have to impose that on them. Because he didn't say, I'm going to sing in the Spirit, I'm going to interpret, and I'm going to sing the interpretation of it as well. He didn't say that. Hello. Because when I say I'm singing in the Spirit, clearly I'm singing out of the realms of tongues. I'm singing in understanding. It can be the expression of prophecy. It can be the expression of what you might call interpretation of tongues, which I call interpretation of tongues and can call interpretation of tongues, because I do it. I understand this because I live in it and I give myself to it. I have the gifting. I have that operation of the Holy Ghost. I know more about it. I can understand the text because I've experienced. Try to tell the people, the Inuits, up and beyond the tree line what trees look like. They'll kind of get it. But you know what? Come walk around the forest a little while, and then now you can talk more specifically about the tree. Because after you tell the Inuit about what the trees look like and what it's like to be in the forest, they're still walking around in the tundra,
right,
where there are no trees.
Right.
And so they can go tell their next Inuit friend about what it's like to be in the forest and what trees are like. But it's going to be kind of odd when they tell the story. Are you with me?
Yeah.
Those are going to be different creatures all together. So, once again, you are fully equipped to be able to make known these wonderful truths.
Yeah.
And it's not about intellectual conversation and debate anyways. It's about just helping people to be armed against the liar, the thief, the one who wants to take from them this flow of the Spirit. And more importantly, to be armed not only with the message of salvation, but with the authority to see them get baptized in the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Can't talk about it without just being so overwhelmed. Overwhelmed in every part of my emotion and my breath and my very being. Hallelujah. So you can pray with it. Pray in the Spirit. Sing in the Spirit. And I understand this. Paul really emphasized what he's saying here because he's going to say, yeah, you give thanks excellently, but the people who are unlearned, they don't have a clue what you're saying. Do you hear that?
Yeah.
Huh? Right? He said, you go ahead, give thanks excellently. I'm just giving thanks excellently. It's a language that no man understandeth, only God understands it. And then I begin to, I'm giving excellent praise because it's pure Holy Ghost worship and Father. But everybody who's unlearned are those who are in the realms of just trying to get some information. They don't know anything about this. How can they say amen at your giving of thanks, even though it is most excellent, seeing that they do not understand what you're saying? Look, you can't crawl over top of that and say singing in the Spirit was just a prophetic song like David sang. Once you got verse 17, we just nailed that hammer completely. We just nailed that nail all the way, hammered it all the way through the wood, okay? You can't get it back out. It's done. Are you listening?
Yeah.
And it's now after this that then Paul begins to say, turn his attention to the message. Now, he said, look, guys, we've got to excel over here. Praise God, what you're doing is good. I'm in there too. And I'm going to tell you right now, I speak in tongues more than y'all. But let me scale this thing for you about your need to excel. Let me scale it for you. I would rather say five words, even though I speak in tongues more than y'all, I'm telling everybody about tongues. First thing I ask them is, have they got tongues yet? Can you hear that?
Yeah.
And I'm talking textually too. Have you received the Holy Ghost since you believed? And we know tongues was hooked up with that in Paul's heart. Huh? Do you understand what I'm saying? Did I lose anybody there? I want to make sure I didn't lose anyone there. Somebody said, oh, he's added a bunch of information to the text. No, I brought other verses of Scripture that are part of understanding the full picture into what I was saying. He's saying, I speak in tongues more than y'all. I'll make sure everybody's received this wonderful outpouring of baptismal anointing. But let me scale for you why it I see and why it is so important for you to excel now. I would rather speak 5 words with the understanding than 10,000 words in tongues so that the church may be edified. All he's doing is underscoring the need to excel. He's not doing away with tongues or demoting that which has already been elevated to the highest spiritual tier, first and foremost by what happened in Acts chapter 2, verse 4, because it is absolutely the witness of that you will be endued with power from on high. It's the promise of the Father having received the gift of the Holy Ghost. He's poured forth that which you see and hear, and what they saw and hear was a bunch of people speaking in the heavenly language as the Holy Ghost gave them utterance. It's unimpeachable. It's unimpeachable. In every commentary, and I am amazed that it's the Roman Catholics who are at least willing to step up and say, this is what the text says. And the denominationals want to just go and play their little patty cake devil games, talking against God the Holy Ghost. And then they can rejoice in the fact that I'm a nobody with a small church so that they can write me off. You can write me off, but you can't write the Word of God off. And you know what I'm saying is true. Go back and read it again. Amen. It's true.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God's Word is truth no matter who speaks it.
True. Yeah. Amen.
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 And so now, having dealt with that, he now turns to the order of how any prophecy needs to be being delivered. Guys, you can't be talking over one another. Everybody can't be giving a message all at the same time. And that is perfectly sensible. For someone to say everybody can't be praying all at the same time makes no sense at all in any context. Just eliminate tongues for a minute and let's reason together. To say that everybody can't sing at the same time is just absolutely as unreasonable. Now just throw the language of the Spirit, hallelujah, which is this glory flow in there, and we should have no problems. But for in any context, for anyone to say that we're now trying to talk and communicate with each other and to the body of Christ, it's going to have to be done one by one. Otherwise, nobody's going to be able to understand what's being said. And so what Paul is going to do concerning this time of giving the message and delivering the message, and I've been in the flow. I know what it's like when that gifting is there and everybody who's sensitive to the gifting, as soon as prophecy begins to flow, if you're not imprisoned by fear and doubt and unbelief, that prophecy anointing will hit you and you can prophesy too. It's seen all the way through the Bible. As soon as somebody starts prophesying, that prophecy will fall on everybody. That is sensitive or that, you know, God opens up to receive it. Huh? Some unlikely characters started prophesying, you know, in the Bible because the Lord just opened them up to the authority of it and it took them over. Praise God. And you can just say, Lord, I want you to do that to me all the time.
Yes, amen.
But so I know what it's like with a gift of tongues, when it's a gift of tongues for a message, specifically for a message. That anointing's there and it hits one person and the message, you can understand the message that it's tongues. See, there's diversity of tongues. Did you know that? The scripture talks about diversity of tongues. It literally is from a Greek word that means families or natures. So it's types. It's families. It's types of tongues. There's types of tongues for singing. There's a type of tongue for prayer. There's different types of and expressions and tongues within the category of prayer. There are tongues even, and I can expand this some more because I'm used to it. I function in it for miracles, for healings. There's different types of tongues. But for the classification which we're dealing with right now, two hands for beginners, because I've already lost so many people to begin with, two hands for beginners, there is a diversity of tongues or a different family of tongues when it comes to message. And so those of us who are discerning of it, we recognize, oh, that's for a message in tongues. That's just not just praying in tongues or singing in tongues. That's for a message that needs to be interpreted. And that is it carries with it a special anointing. But not only can you discern it as you grow and mature, but context. In other words, if I'm preaching and John starts screaming out in tongues right now, then that's the message. You have to deliver an interpretation if you start, and I have to give place to it. I have no right to forbid it. This is divine order. Huh? Afterwards, we might have a conversation. But the divine order is you deliver it and the others judge, okay, as to whether it was. If you don't interpret, then Paul says, okay, I'm gonna add this. The optimal situation. I'm preaching. I've got a flow going on here. I'm trying to home a point by the Holy Ghost to bring you to a place of decision, to bring you to a place of breakthrough. And now somebody started speaking in tongues. God, the Holy Ghost, is, you know, wants to make some additional points. So the optimal thing then is we get an immediate interpretation of that. But if that doesn't happen, Paul then says, okay, you can allow now for two or three occurrences. Literally, the Greek language is for occurrences, and then require an interpretation. And he's saying there in that context, if there is no interpretation, now I have the authority to shut that down, and I'm not forbidding tongues. Okay? But there is not a limit because it's by occurrence. So if there's two or three, sutara, and I want you to experience it. God, the Holy Ghost, wants you to hunger for this and experience it, where the gift of the message of tongues is so powerful and dominant in the meeting that there's two or three tongues go, and then there's an interpretation, and then there can be two or three more tongues. Once again, back to the optimal, a tongue interpretation. And, you know, but there could be two or at the most three, and then an interpretation. And there's no limit. It can go so on to and so on until everybody does it, because Paul himself, in the same chapter, in the same verses, says that he's blessing them and rejoicing the fact that every one of them has a tongue. Yes. And every one of them has an interpretation of tongues. What a church meeting! Yes. Woo! I've been in them. And I'm going to tell you right now, when I'm around people who are matured in the Spirit, I participate with it. And if nobody else kicks it off, I'll kick it off. Hallelujah. 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 Because I grew up in Pentecost. I didn't grow up in the postmodern age. I grew up in Pentecost. Praise God. I got to watch the function of it go on. There's greater latitude to the tongues and interpretation of tongues than what we give it. You know, it doesn't have to be locked into someone saying, you know, in a loud voice, standing up and, you know, grabbing hold of the sound of the prophet and saying, "Thus saith the Lord." It can be that, but it doesn't have to be like that. There's some people who function in interpretation of tongues. I mean, it's fine if somebody's going to get up and say, every time, hear ye. That's fine. So long as what comes in after that carries with it the piercing, anointing of God the Holy Ghost that reveals the secrets of the heart. See, I got plenty of power to judge. I have an ability to understand what's going to happen. But once again, I watch people in been lobotomized by an education system that are so overwhelmed by the spirit of fear and are so overwhelmed by the fear of failure that they don't have the ability to even begin in God. Just overwhelmed by the sense of fear of failure. Just always wearing their feelings on the sleeve. Laurel and Hardy, You're going to have to grow up. I'm not going to tolerate it. Ask my kids. No whining in my house. No whining. You can't whine. No whiners. I will not allow you to grow up and be a whiner. And then I find people fully mature. Now I got to help them with their whining. And they want me to be empathetic and sympathetic with their whining? No. Because it's going to keep you from your best. Huh? People will let men be their coach to make them excellent in sports. And Paul uses that as the template for ministry. If you're going to strive for masteries, if you're going for the Olympics, You're not going to get anywhere unless you do it lawfully. You're going to have to get you a coach who is going to absolutely criticize your every... He's going to criticize the way you hold your lips. He's going to criticize the way you breathe. Eh? Come on, you sports people. Everything's criticized. Huh? Your little toe wasn't right in the block. How did you even see my little toe? Because I know the form of your shoe if your little toe is properly positioned. You got to be kidding me. No, I'm not. What is that going to do for me? It's going to shave off, you know, a millionth of a second. And every millionth counts here. Come on, you know what I'm saying? Every one of you know that it's giving yourself to athletics. You know what I'm saying? But yet now we have somebody comes in the realms of the Spirit and begins to want to finally hone you and help you and instruct you. Now all of a sudden it's all offensive. You got to get over that. It's a prison of fear. It's a failure, a fear of failure. It's a sensitivity to the things you need to be insensitive to. I'm gonna stand up. I'm on bully. Listen, come on, man. I feel this thing burning on the inside of me. I'm gonna deliver it, right or wrong. I'm gonna deliver it. And I'm gonna be better for the next time. Are you listening to me? Every time you preach, the sermon gets stronger. Every time you prophesy, the prophecy gets stronger. Every time you speak in the language of the Spirit, the language gets stronger. If you're waiting for it to be stronger before you ever begin, nothing's ever gonna start. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Hello. Yeah. You got to do these things. Hallelujah. Yeah. Praise God. There's got to be room in every meeting for everybody to get baptized in the Holy Ghost. Yeah. And if we don't allow anybody to speak in the language at the same time, nobody's going to get baptized.
True.
If we're going to control and orchestrate that which only God can do, it will never happen. And as soon as man tries to orchestrate that which only God can orchestrate, it becomes man-made, it becomes pathetic, it becomes actually a shame and a false representation. These things only can happen as a result of hungry hearts crying out to God, saying, God, I want you your way. I want your church. Oh, Lord, I want the things that you purpose to be the manifestation of the Spirit be revealed through me.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. That's what my book's about. Hallelujah. Shupuropana hikiyata. Hallelujah. If I could just get all of the protesters and the persecutors who are so against everybody speaking in tongues, and they have no right scripturally to be against it, to give themselves to saying the order of the church is that everybody should be prophesying one by one. You'll get changed quick. Suddenly, when you want that and you're giving yourself over to that order, oh, you're going to be needing some tongues. You're going to be needing some help from the Holy Ghost. You're going to be needing some baptismal outpouring of the Spirit through your life. You're going to be needing some rivers because this ain't working out. But what we would rather do is we would rather shoot down what we don't like and at the same time have no responsibility to do those things which we are certain of are supposed to be done. The Bible isn't a smorgasbord of fine foods. Some you can take, others you can leave. Huh? You're supposed to eat a plenty of it all. This is one area of your life that you can be fat. You can delight yourself in fatness.
Amen.
This is where fatness equals glory. Boom, brasa, bohuki. Hallelujah. Praise God. Well, thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. The Lord gave me some really good paragraphs in here on prophecy. I'm going to go through them. But, and I just noticed that you did a table of contents. Thank you. Thank you. Tongues belong. Here's the table of contents on this, and I'm closing. There's introduction. Tongues belong in church. That's the second chapter. Hallelujah. That's a breakthrough for a lot of us right there. It shouldn't be a great revelation, but right now, that's the point we've come to. That's where we find ourselves today. Tongues belong in church is a profound revelation. Hallelujah. Next chapter is baptism in the Holy Ghost manifested by tongues. The next chapter is praying and singing in the Spirit. The next chapter is interpretation of tongues. Next chapter is the need for tongues. The next chapter after that is come let us reason together. Can I read you one paragraph? Come let us reason together. And then the final chapter is prophecy. Let me just read you one of these, one paragraph out of Come Let Us Reason Together. Have you ever wondered why it is okay if people pray and sing and speak in the heavenly? Have you ever wondered why it is not okay if people pray, sing, and speak in the heavenly language in church, but it is okay if we do not prophesy, do not cast out devils, and do not minister healing and miracles? What if we took every dimension of the manifestation of the Holy Spirit and display of the power of God out of the life of Jesus? What would his ministry look like? He would have been a preacher who described the glory and splendor of heaven, but could have never displayed it. He would have talked about how much God loves everyone, but would have never had the ability to demonstrate it in any significant level. When the centurion would have come to Jesus regarding his dying servant, Jesus would have said, "Put your trust in God." When the leper came crying out to be cleansed, they would have heard, "Rejoice in your affliction." When Jesus came desiring, when Jairus came desiring Jesus to heal his daughter and then discovered that she was dead, the message from Jesus would have been, "It's not always God's will to heal. Put your trust in providence." And we can't run a risk that's what our ministry would look like. Because we're sitting here laughing about, my goodness, aren't we glad that wasn't how Jesus ministered. But that's the ministry you have without the Holy Ghost.
That's right.
And when you reject the baptism of the Holy Ghost, which is going to come with the language of the Spirit, you can never have anything other than that. Pathetic description of what it looks like to minister. Huh? Because we have to all admit that is one pathetic description. And I know there's people upset at me because I said that. They said, "Oh, no, it would have been fine for Jesus to minister like that." No, sorry, dear saint, loved one. It would not have been fine for Jesus to say, "No, it's not always God's will to heal. Put your trust in providence." There was nothing about his life that said that would be okay. What we want to try to do is cast those things that we're holding onto Jesus so we feel better about it. No, what Jesus did needs to be cast onto us. Praise God. Bring it. Bring it. And we need to be crying out to God painfully, desperately, insistently. Oh, Lord, let your miracles be revealed. Lord, let the manifestation of your power. Lord, don't let these devil workers, don't let these witches and these sorcerers and these worldly people demonstrate a greater power than your saints. Oh God, let the word of knowledge be strong through my life. Lord, let the word of wisdom be strong through my life. Oh God, let there be such a display of those things which only you can do that every man's mouth is stopped, that every reasoning of men is put to silence. I'm telling you, Father hears that prayer. He's on page with that. There's no doubt about it. It's the cries of a heart. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So I pray that you strengthen. I pray that you know and feel more confident that it's okay for you to pray in church.
Amen.
And I just want you to explain it that way. I want you to understand it that way. It's okay for you to pray in church and pray anyway. Hallelujah. Amen. So hallelujah. And usually when we're praying in church, we want to be all praying all together. And I tell you right now, and I know most preachers are like this, even in the Church of the Nazarene Methodist, they want people to step up in the prayer. And when some people just sit around and be silent whilst other people are doing the work. Come on, let's all pray together. There's not a church that I know of that doesn't someplace say, "Let's all pray together." Even when I'm in Catholic church, you're reading it off a page. It says, "Time for us all pray together. Our Father," or whatever. They're all praying together. No, don't you allow that. Out of order. One by one. Of course, that's not true. Of course, that's not true. So just be confident. You can pray together, hallelujah, all at once. No, we just recently had some people leave this church because they don't believe you're supposed to all pray together in tongues. Huh? And I'm still praying, believing God, that we'll all sing together in tongues. Hallelujah. I said, well, you better get used to it because I'm believing God for a whole lot more.
Amen.
You ain't seen nothing.
I'm leaving and I'm taking my money with me.
Oh. That is funny, actually. No. Thank you, Jesus. You're going to need all that money. You need to hang on there. Jesus. Kusha prapapatas. Hallelujah. And listen, I just want to say this in closing. Let God give you in wisdom and understanding about how you can hook together with us to, so that we together can be more effective administering to a lost and dying world. And especially within the forms of the internet that we have right now, all the various different social media. Come on, come on, let's do this thing together.
Amen.
Carry the responsibility of it. Amen. Carry the weight of it. And what you're going to see is you're going to see a greater display of the power of God being manifested through your life because you put your hand to the plow. You're carrying the weight of the responsibility of the ministry, which once again, fundamentally, and I think that I need to say this more, because I'm a multitasker. God's got me doing a lot of different things. And I need to say it more to emphasize it. You put your hand to the plow in the local ministry. That is a responsibility that you have in the kingdom of God. You wear it. You carry it. You don't leave it all for somebody else to do.
Amen.
Okay? Hallelujah. The Lord says, you don't work, you don't eat.
Right.
And we're talking about eating as a spiritual food here.
Yeah.
Talking about drinking a spiritual drink.
Yeah.
And it's not earned. It's just, come on.
Amen.
You have to participate. It's about participating.
Yeah.
Huh?
Amen.
And nobody's sitting around going, well, there are some people sitting around going, you expect me to work to eat. There are certain people sitting around, but most people are not doing that. And most people don't seem it, call it legalistic that you have to work to have breakfast. Right? So we got to get rid of these wrong definitions, misapplications, twisted conversations, huh? Lay a hold of God, lay a hold of the truth, do what's right, watch God's results. Praise the name of Jesus. Pura mamande, pura mamonde, pura mamondaya, pura sande ikito, ho manaya, huri bestivina naha, ha manaya. You want to get strong, you want to get developed in the things of God, you get in church all the time and you participate with the move of God and you be the one who brings the move of God.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
And you watch what happens. Everybody stand with me. Amen.
Yes.
And we're going to make sure that everybody knows when this, the first day that we put it on Amazon, right? Because if everybody goes on there and we just get as many people as we possibly can to go on and buy it, write a review about it, then it's going to get promoted in within Amazon. As I understand it, it gets more exposure in the internet then. And then that way, when you've got some desperate soul from the Roman Catholic Church typing in, is tongues for today, it's this book is going to pop up.
Amen.
And I want this book to pop up and before the Antichrist spirit book pops up. And so do you.
Hallelujah.
I think the last time I looked, one of our YouTubes was like over 15,000 hits. It was Nepal, and there's several of them. So I mean, there's several of them that got posted by different people, and I'm telling you, I know that every time somebody watches that, they get seated by the power of God. There are people who have come back to Jesus watching that. There's people who come to Jesus watching that. There's people who consecrated their lives in a deeper way. Just coming out, there's people gone into ministry looking at that. And I can't overemphasize, your work of labor is not in vain. And let's do it together. Let's make sure that we're everything that we're doing is reaching the lost out there, but we're also participating together, bring people in the church. And I'm coming back to those 10 that are watching me right now. You're in a building of 10. I promise you, you grab a hold of the baptism of the Holy Ghost, you begin to get together. You don't allow anything to separate you. Everybody begins to labor for one cause, to build a church. There's no limit. There's no limit. There's too many hurting, dying, suffering people. Thank you, Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Everybody just stretch your hands towards heaven. Whatever you have need of for whatever you have need of right now in the name of Jesus Christ, if it's healing for your body, strengthening for your spirit, peace for your mind, now receive in Jesus' name. Those of you watching by web, I know you felt it. Hallelujah. And by Facebook right now or by YouTube. Power of God's right there. The Spirit of the living God. God the Holy Ghost will come upon you right now. The glory and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. You will receive provision for whatever need you have right now in the name of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. Shout to the Lord with a voice of triumph. Amen. Will everybody find somebody, hug them, tell them that you love them, bless them in Jesus' name.